0900 hours.
The pounding, that terrifying pounding, and the shaking of the floor awakened him abruptly. He rolled over and got to his feet, instantly alert. He saw Beth standing by the monitors. "What is it?" he cried. "What is it?" "What is what?" Beth said. She seemed calm. She smiled at him. Norman looked around. The alarms hadn't gone off. The lights weren't flashing. I don't know, he trailed off. "You thought we were under attack again?" she said. He nodded. "Why would you think that, Norman?" she said. Beth was again looking at him in an odd way, an appraising way, her stare very direct and cool. There was no hint of seductiveness in her. If anything, she conveyed the suspiciousness of the old Beth. "You're a man, and you're a problem." "Harry's still unconscious, isn't he? So why would you think we were being attacked?" "I don't know. I guess I was dreaming." Beth shrugged. "Maybe you felt the vibration of me walking on the floor," she said. "Anyway, I'm glad you decided to sleep." The same appraising stare, as if there was something wrong with him. "You haven't slept enough, Norman." "None of us have." "You, particularly." "Maybe you're right." He had to admit he felt better now that he had slept for a couple of hours. He smiled. "Did you eat all the coffee in Danish?" "There isn't any coffee in Danish, Norman." "I know." "Then why would you say that?" she asked seriously. "It was a joke, Beth." "Oh. Just a joke. You know, a humorous reflection of our condition." "I see." She was working with the screens. "By the way, what did you find out about that balloon?" "Balloon?" "The surface balloon. Remember we talked about it?" He shook his head. He didn't remember. "Before I went out to the sub, I asked about the control codes to send a balloon to the surface, and you said you'd look in the computer and see if you could find out how to do it."
"I did?"
"Yes, Norman, you did." He thought back. He remembered how he and Beth had lifted Harry's inert, surprisingly heavy body off the floor, setting him on the couch, and how they had staunched the flow of blood from his nose while Beth had started an intravenous line, which she knew how to do from her work with lab animals. In fact, she had made a joke, saying she hoped Harry fared better than her lab animals, since they usually ended up dead. Then Beth had volunteered to go to the sub, and he had said he'd stay with Harry. That was what he remembered. Nothing about balloons.
"Sure, sure," Beth said, "because the communication said we're supposed to acknowledge transmission, and that means a radio balloon sent to the surface. And we figured, with the storm abating, the surface conditions must be calm enough to allow the balloon to ride without snapping the wire. So it was a question of how to release the balloon. And you said you'd look for the control commands."
"I really don't remember," he said.
"I'm sorry."
"Norman, we have to work together in these last few hours," Beth said.
I agree, Beth. Absolutely."
"How are you feeling now?" she said.
"Okay. Pretty good, in fact."
"Good," she said. "Hang in there, Norman. It's only a few more hours." She hugged him warmly. But when she released him, he saw in her eyes that same detached, appraising look. An hour later, they figured out how to release the balloon. They distantly heard a metallic sizzle as the wire unwound from the outside pool, trailing behind the inflated balloon as it shot towards the surface. Then there was a long pause.
"What's happening?" Norman said.
"We're 1,000 feet down," Beth said. "It takes a while for the balloon to get to the surface." Then the screen changed, and they got a readout of the surface conditions. Wind was down to 15 knots. Waves were running 6 feet. Barometric pressure was 20.9. Sunlight was recorded.
"Good news," Beth said. "The surface is okay."
Norman was staring at the screen, thinking about the fact that the sunlight was recorded.
He had never longed for sunlight before. It was funny, what you took for granted. Now the thought of seeing sunlight struck him as being unbelievably pleasurable. He could imagine no greater joy than to see the sun and clouds and the blue sky. What are you thinking?
I'm thinking, I can't wait to get out of here.
Me too, Beth said. But it won't be long now.
Pong, 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 pong.
Norman was checking Harry, and he spun at the sound. What is it, Beth? Take it easy, Beth said at the console. I'm just trying to figure out how to work this thing.
Work what?
The side-scanning sonar. False aperture sonar. I don't know why they call it false aperture. Do you know what that refers to? False aperture?
No, I don't, Norman said. Turn it off, please.
The sound was unnerving. It's marked FAS, which I think stands for false aperture sonar, but it also says side scanning, and it's very confusing.
Beth, turn it off.
Pong, 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 pong.
Sure, of course, Beth said. Why do you want to know how to work that thing anyway? Norman said. He felt irritable, as if she had intentionally annoyed him with that sound.
Just in case, Beth said.
In case what, for Christ's sake? You said yourself that Harry's unconscious. There aren't going to be any more attacks.
Take it easy, Norman, Beth said. I want to be prepared, that's all.
Zero 720 hours.
He couldn't talk her out of it. She insisted on going outside and wiring the explosives around the ship. It was an absolutely fixed idea in her mind. But why, Beth? He kept saying.
Because I'll feel better after I do it, she said.
But there isn't any reason to do it.
I'll feel better if I do, she insisted. And in the end, he couldn't stop her.
He saw her now, a small figure with a single glowing light from her helmet, moving from one crate of explosives to another. She opened each crate and removed large yellow cones, which looked like the cones that the highway repair trucks use. These cones were wired together, and when the wiring was completed, a small red light glowed at the tip. He saw the small red lights all up and down the length of the ship. It made him uneasy. When she left, he had said to her, "But you won't wire up the explosives near the habitat."
"No, Norman, I won't."
"Promise me."
"I told you, I won't. If it's going to upset you, I won't."
"It's going to upset me."
"Okay, okay."
Now the red lights were strung along the length of the ship, starting at the dimly visible tail, which rose out of the coral bottom. Beth moved farther north, towards the rest of the unopened crates. Norman looked at Harry, who snored loudly but remained unconscious. He paced back and forth in D-cylinder, and then went to the monitors. The screen blinked.
"I am coming."
"Oh God," he thought. And in the next moment he thought, "How can this be happening? It can't be happening." Harry was still out cold. How could it be happening?
"I am coming for you."
"Beth!" Her voice sounded tinny on the intercom.
"Yes, Norman."
"Get the hell out of there."
"Do not be afraid,"
the screen said.
"What is it, Norman?" she said.
"I'm getting something on the screen." "Check Harry. He must be waking up." "He's not! Get back here, Beth!"
"I am coming now."
"All right, Norman, I'm heading back," she said.
fast, Beth. But he didn't need to say that. Already he could see her light bouncing as she ran across the bottom. She was at least 100 yards away from the habitat. He heard her breathing hard on the intercom. Can you see anything, Norman?
No, nothing.
He was straining to look towards the horizon, where the squid had appeared. The first thing had always been a green glow on the horizon, but he saw no glow now. Beth was panting.
I can feel something, Norman. I feel the water surging, strong.
The screen flashed.
I will kill you.
Don't you see anything out here?
Beth said.
No, I don't see anything at all.
He saw Beth, alone on the muddy bottom, her light the solitary focus of his attention.
I can feel it, Norman. It's close. Jesus God. What about the alarms?
Nothing, Beth.
Jesus.
Her breath came in hissing gasps as she ran. Beth was in good shape, but she couldn't exert herself like this in the atmosphere. Not for long, he thought. Already he could see she was moving more slowly, her helmet lamp bobbing more slowly.
Norman?
Yes, Beth, I'm here.
Norman, I don't know if I can make it.
Beth, you can make it. Slow down.
It's here. I can feel it.
I don't see anything, Beth. He heard a rapid, sharp clicking sound. At first he thought it was static on the line, and then he realized it was her teeth chattering as she shivered. With this exertion, she should be getting overheated, but instead she was getting cold. He didn't understand.
Cold, Norman.
Slow down, Beth.
Can't. Talking. Close.
She was slowing down, despite herself. She had come into the area of the habitat lights, and she was no more than 10 yards away from the hatch, but he could see her limbs moving slowly, clumsily. And now at last he could see something swirling the muddy sediment behind her in the darkness below the light. It was like a tornado, a swirling cloud of muddy sediment. He couldn't see what was inside the cloud, but he sensed the power within it.
Close.
No. She stumbled. Fell. The swirling cloud moved towards her.
I will kill you now.
Beth got to her feet, looked back, saw the churning cloud bearing down on her. Something about it filled Norman with a deep horror. A horror from a childhood. The stuff of nightmares.
Norman!
Then Norman was running, not really knowing what he was going to do, but propelled by the vision he had seen, thinking only that he had to do something. He had to take some action. And he went through B into A and looked at his suit, but there wasn't time, and the black water in the open hatch was spitting and swirling, and he saw Beth's gloved hand below the surface, flailing. She was right there beneath him, and she was the only other one. And without thinking, he jumped into the black water and went down. The shock of the cold made him want to scream. It tore at his lungs. His whole body was instantly numb, and he felt a second of hideous paralysis. The water churned and tossed him like a great wave. He was powerless to fight it. His head banged on the underside of the habitat. He could see nothing at all. He reached for Beth, throwing his arms blindly in all directions. His lungs burned. The water spun him in circles, upended him. He touched her, lost her. The water continued to spin him. He grabbed her. Something. An arm. He was already losing feeling, already feeling slower and stupider. He pulled. He saw a ring of light above him. The hatch. He kicked his legs, but he did not seem to move. The circle came no closer. He kicked again, dragging Beth like a dead weight. Perhaps she was dead. His lungs burned. It was the worst pain he had ever felt in his life. He fought the pain, and he fought the angry, churning water, and he kept kicking towards the light. That was his only thought. To kick to the light. To come closer to the light. To reach the light. The light. The light. The light. The images were confusing. Beth's suited body clinging on the metal inside the airlock. His own knee bleeding on the metal of the hatch. The drops of the blood splattering. Beth's shaking hands reaching for her helmet. Twisting it. Trying to get the helmet unlocked. Hand shaking. Water in the hatch. Sucking. Surging. Lights in his eyes. A terrible pain somewhere. Rust very close to his face. A sharp edge of metal. Cold metal. Cold air. Lights in his eyes dimming. Fading. Blackness. The sensation of warmth was pleasant. He heard a hissing roar in his ears. He looked up and saw Beth, out of her suit, looming large above him, adjusting the big space heater, turning the power up. She was still shivering, but she was turning up the heat. He closed his eyes. We made it, he thought. We're still together. We're still okay. We made it. He relaxed. There was a crawly sensation over his body. From the cold, he thought. His body warming from the cold. The crawly sensation was not pleasant. And the hissing was not pleasant either. It was sibilant. Intermittent. Something slithered softly under his chin as he lay on the deck. He opened his eyes and saw a silvery white tube. And then he focused and saw the tiny beady eyes and the flickering tongue. It was a snake. A sea snake. He froze. He looked down, moving only his eyes. His entire body was covered with white snakes. The crawly sensation came from dozens of snakes, coiling around his ankles, sliding between his legs, over his chest. He felt a cool, slithering motion across his forehead. He closed his eyes, feeling horror as the snake body moved over his face, down his nose, brushed over his lips, and then moved away. He listened to the hissing of the reptiles and thought of how poisonous Beth had said they were. Beth, he thought. Where is Beth? He did not move. He felt snakes coiling around his neck, slipping over his shoulders, sliding between the fingers of his hands. He did not want to open his eyes. He felt a surge of nausea. God, he thought. I'm going to throw up. He felt snakes under his armpits and felt snakes sliding past his groin. He burst into a cold sweat. He fought the nausea. Beth, he thought. He did not want to speak. Beth. He listened to the hissing, and then, when he couldn't stand it anymore, he opened his eyes and saw the mass of coiling, writhing white flesh. The tiny heads. The flicked, forked tongues. He closed his eyes again. He felt one crawling up the leg of his jumpsuit, moving against his bare skin. Don't move, Norman. It was Beth. He could hear the tension in her voice. He looked up, could not see her, only her shadow. He heard her say, Oh God, what time is it? And he thought, The hell with the time? Who cares what time it is? It didn't make any sense to him. I have to know the time, Beth was saying. He heard her feet moving on the deck. The time. She was moving away, leaving him. The snake slid over his ears, under his chin, past his nostrils, the body damp and slithering. Then he heard feet on the deck and a metallic clang as she threw open the hatch. He opened his eyes to see her bending over him, grabbing the snakes in great handfuls, throwing them down the hatch into the water. Snakes writhed in her hands, twisted around her wrist, but she shook them off, tossed them aside. Some of the snakes didn't land in the water and coiled on the deck, but most of the snakes were off his body now. One more crawling up his leg, towards his groin. He felt it moving quickly backwards. She was pulling it out by the tail. Jesus, careful. The snake was out, flung over her shoulder. You can get up, Norman, she said. He jumped to his feet and promptly vomited.
Zero 700 hours.
He had a murderous, pounding headache. It made the habitat light seem unpleasantly bright. And he was cold. Beth had wrapped him in blankets and had moved him next to the big space heaters and D-cylinder, so close that the hum of the electrical elements were very loud in his ears. But he was still cold. He looked down at her now as she bandaged his cut knee. How is it? He said. Not good, she said. It's right down to the bone. But you'll be all right. It's only a few more hours now. Yes, I... Ouch! Sorry, almost done. Beth was following first aid directions from the computer. To distract his mind from the pain, he read the screen. Minor medical, non-lethal complications. Choose one. That's what I need, he said. Some microsleep. Or better yet, some serious microsleep. Yes, we all do. A thought occurred to him. Beth, remember when you were pulling the snakes off of me? What was all that you were talking about the time of the day? Sea snakes are diurnal, Beth said. Many poisonous snakes are alternatively aggressive and passive in 12-hour cycles, corresponding to day and night. During the day, when they're passive, you can handle them and they'll never bite. For example, in India, the highly poisonous banded crate has never been known to bite during the day, even when children play with them. But at night, watch out. So I was trying to determine which cycle the sea snakes were on, until I decided that this must be their passive daytime cycle. How'd you figure that out? Because you were still alive. Then she had used her bare hands to remove the snakes, knowing that they wouldn't bite her either. With your hands full of snakes, you look like Medusa. What is that, a rock star? No, it's a mythological figure. The one who killed her children? She asked with a quick, suspicious glance. Beth, ever alert to a veiled insult. No, that's somebody else. That was Medea. Medusa was a mythical woman with a head full of snakes who turned men to stone if they looked at her. Perseus killed her by making her look at a reflection in his polished shield. I'm sorry, Norman, not my field. It was remarkable, he thought, that at one time every educated Western person knew these figures from mythology and the stories behind them intimately. As intimately as they knew the stories of family and friends. Myths had once represented the common knowledge of humanity, and they served as a kind of map of consciousness. But now, a well-educated person such as Beth knew nothing of myths at all. It was as if the men had decided that the map of human consciousness had changed. But had it really changed? He shivered. Still cold, Norman? Yeah, but the worst thing is the headache. You're probably dehydrated. Let's see if I can find you something to drink. She went to the first aid box on the wall. You know, that was a hell of a thing you did, Beth said, jumping in like that without a suit. That water is only a couple of degrees above freezing. It was very brave. Stupid, but brave, she smiled. You saved my life, Norman. I didn't think, Norman said. I just did it.
And then he told her how, when he had seen her outside, with the churning cloud of sediment approaching her, he had felt an old and childish horror, something from a distant memory. "You know what it was?" he said. "It reminded me of the tornado in The Wizard of Oz. That tornado scared the bejesus out of me when I was a kid. I just didn't want to see it happen again." And he thought, perhaps these are our nude myths. Dorothy and Toto and the Wicked Witch. Captain Nemo and the Giant Squid. "Well," Bev said, "whatever the reason, you saved my life. Thank you." "Anytime," Norman said. He smiled. "Just don't do it again." "No, I won't be going out again." She brought back a drink in a paper cup. It was syrupy and sweet. "What is this?" "Isotonic glucose supplement. Drink it." He sipped it again, but it was unpleasantly sweet. Across the room, the console screen still said,
"I will kill you now."
He looked at Harry, still unconscious, with the intravenous lines running into his arm. Harry had been unconscious all this time. He hadn't faced the implications of that. It was time to do it now. He didn't want to do it, but he had to. He said, "Beth, why do you think all of this is happening?" "All of what?" "The screen, printing words, and another manifestation coming to attack us?" Beth looked at him in a flat, neutral way. "What do you think, Norman?" "It's not Harry." "No, it's not." "Then why is it happening?" Norman said. He got up, pulling the blankets tighter around him. He flexed his bandaged knee. It hurt, but not too badly. Norman moved to the porthole and looked out the window. In the distance, he could see the string of red lights from the explosives Beth had set up and armed. He had never understood why she wanted to do that. She had acted so strangely about the whole thing. He looked down toward the base of the habitat. She had acted so strangely about the whole thing. He looked down towards the habitat. Red lights were glowing there, too, just below the porthole. She had armed the explosives around the habitat. "Beth, what have you done?"
"Done?"
"You armed the explosives around DH-8. "Yes, Norman," she said. She stood watching him, very still, very calm. "Beth, you promised you wouldn't do that."
"I know. I had to."
"How are they wired? Where's the button, Beth?"
"There is no button. They're set on automatic vibration sensors."
"You mean they'll go off automatically?"
"Yes, Norman."
"Beth, this is crazy. Someone is still making these manifestations. Who is doing that, Beth?"
She smiled slowly, a lazy cat smile, as if he was secretly amusing her. "Don't you really know?" He did know. "Yes," he thought. He knew, and it chilled him.
"You're making these manifestations, Beth."
"No, Norman," she said, still calm. "I'm not doing it. You are."
Zero, 640 hours.
He thought back years ago, to the early days of his training, when he had worked in the state hospital at Borgio. Norman had been sent by his supervisor to make a progress report on a particular patient. The man was in his late 20s, pleasant and well-educated. Norman talked to him about all sorts of things. The Oldsmobile hydraulic transmission, the best surfing beaches, Adlai Stevenson's recent presidential campaign, Whitney Ford's pitching, even Freudian theory. The man was quite charming, although he chain-smoked and seemed to have an underlying tension. Finally, Norman got around to asking him why he'd been sent to the hospital. The man didn't remember why. He was sorry, he just couldn't seem to recall. Under repeated questioning from Norman, the man became less charming, more irritable. Finally, he turned threatening and angry, pounding the table, demanding that Norman talk about something else. Only then did it dawn on Norman who this man was. Alan Whitaker, who, as a teenager, had murdered his mother and sister in their trailer in the Palm Desert, and then had gone on to kill 6 people at a gas station and 3 others in a supermarket parking lot, until he finally turned himself into the police, sobbing, hysterical with guilt and remorse. Whitaker had been in the state hospital for 10 years, and he had brutally attacked several attendants during that time. This was the man who was now enraged, standing up in front of Norman and kicking the table, flinging his chair back against the wall. Norman was still a student. He didn't know how to handle it. He turned to flee the room, but the door behind him was locked. They had locked him in, which is what they always did during interviews with violent patients. Behind him, Whitaker lifted the table and threw it against the wall. He was coming for Norman. Norman had a moment of horrible panic until he heard the locks rattling, and then 3 huge attendants dashed in, grabbed Whitaker, and dragged him away, still screaming and swearing. Norman went directly to his supervisor, demanded to know why he had been set up. The supervisor said to him, "Set up?" "Yes," Norman had said, "set up." The supervisor said, "But weren't you told the man's name beforehand? Didn't the name mean anything to you?" Norman replied that he hadn't really paid attention. "You better pay attention, Norman," the supervisor had said. "You can't ever let down your guard in a place like this. It's too dangerous." Now, looking across the habitat at Beth, he thought, "Pay attention, Norman. You can't let down your guard. Because you're dealing with a crazy person, and you haven't realized it." "I see you don't believe me," Beth said, still very calm. "Are you able to talk?" "Sure," Norman said. "Be logical, all of that?" "Sure," he said, thinking, "I'm not the crazy one here." "All right," Beth said. "Remember when you told me about Harry? How all the evidence pointed to Harry?" "Yes, of course." "You asked me if I could think of another explanation, and I said no." "But there is another explanation, Norman. Some points you conveniently overlooked the first time. Like the jellyfish." "Why the jellyfish?" "It was your little brother, Harry. It was your little brother who was stung by the jellyfish, Norman, and you who felt guilty afterwards. And when does Jerry speak? When you're there, Norman. And when does the squid stop its attack? When you were knocked unconscious, Norman. Not Harry, you." Her voice was so calm, so reasonable. He struggled to consider what she was saying. Was it possible she was right? "Step back. Take the long view," Beth said. "You're a psychologist down here with a bunch of scientists dealing with hardware. There's nothing for you to do down here. You said so yourself. And wasn't there a time in your life when you felt similarly professionally bypassed? Wasn't that an uncomfortable time for you? Didn't you once tell me that you hated that time in your life?" "Yes, but when all the strange things start to happen, the problem isn't hardware anymore. Now it's a psychological problem. It's right up your alley, Norman. Your particular area of expertise. And suddenly you become the center of attention, don't you?" "No," he thought. "This can't be right. When Jerry starts to communicate with us, who notices that he has emotions? Who insists that we deal with Jerry's emotions? None of us are interested in emotions, Norman. Barnes only wants to know about armaments. Ted only wants to talk science. Harry only wants to play logical games. You're the one who's interested in emotions. And who manipulates Jerry, or fails to manipulate him? You, Norman. It's all you.
It can't be,
Norman said. His mind was reeling. He struggled to find a contradiction, and found it. It can't be me, because I haven't been inside the sphere. Yes, you have, Beth said. You just don't remember. He felt battered, repeatedly punched and battered. He couldn't seem to get his balance, and the blows kept coming. Just the way you don't remember that I asked you to look up the balloon codes, Beth was saying in her calm voice. Or the way Barnes asked you about the helium concentrations in E cylinder. He thought, what helium concentrations in E cylinder? When did Barnes ask me about that? There's a lot you don't remember, Norman. Norman said, when did I go inside the sphere? Before the first squid attack. After Harry came out. I was asleep! I was sleeping in my bunk! No, Norman, you weren't. Because Fletcher came to get you, and you were gone. We couldn't find you for about 2 hours, and then you showed up yawning. I don't believe you, he said. I know you don't. You prefer to make it someone else's problem. And you're clever. You're skilled at psychological manipulation, Norman. Remember those tests you conducted? Putting unsuspected people up in an airplane, then telling them the pilot had a heart attack? Scaring them half to death? That's a pretty ruthless way. That's pretty ruthless manipulation, Norman. And down here in the habitat, when all these things started happening, you needed a monster. So you made Harry the monster. But Harry wasn't the monster, Norman. You're the monster. That's why your appearance changed. Why you became ugly. Because you're the monster. But the message said, it said, my name is Harry. Yes, it did. And as you yourself pointed out, the person causing it was afraid that the real name would come out on the screen. Harry, Norman said. The name was Harry. And what's your name? Norman Johnson. Your full name? He paused. Somehow his mouth wasn't working. His brain was blank. I'll tell you what it is, Beth said. I looked it up. It's Norman Harrison Johnson. No, he thought. No. She can't be right. It's hard to accept, Beth was saying in her almost hypnotic voice. I understand that. But if you think about it, you realize you wanted it to come to this. You wanted me to figure it out, Norman. Why, just a few minutes ago, you even told me about the Wizard of Oz, didn't you? You helped me along when I was getting to the point. Or, at least your unconsciousness did. Are you still calm?
Of course I'm calm.
Good. Stay calm, Norman. Let's consider this logically. Will you cooperate with me? What do you want to do? I want to put you under, Norman. Like Harry. He shook his head. It's only for a few hours, Norman, she said. And then she seemed to decide. She moved swiftly towards him, and he saw the syringe in her hand, the glint of the needle, and he twisted away. The needle plunged into the blanket, and he threw it off and ran for the stairs. Norman! Come back here! He was climbing the stairs. He saw Beth running forwards with the needle. He kicked with his foot, got upstairs into her lab, and slammed the hatch down on her. Norman! She pounded on the hatch. Norman stood on it, knowing that she could never lift his weight. Beth continued to pound. Norman Johnson, you open that hatch this minute! No, Beth, I'm sorry. He paused. What could she do? Nothing, he thought. He was safe here. She couldn't get to him up here. She couldn't do anything to him as long as he remained here. Then he saw the metal pivot move in the center of the hatch between his feet. On the other side of the hatch, Beth was spinning the wheel, locking him in.